Welcome to the third day of the EBVF 2020 conference towards a big a European ecosystem for big data and artificial intelligence. And this morning's session, a big data stack for industry, a focus on retail, shipping and insurance. Is big data the real future of emerging business? So my name is Marieke Willems. I'm research communication and stakeholder engagement specialist at Trust IT, and I lead the dissemination work package in Big Data Stack. Before we continue, I'm sure you've seen them over the past 3 days, but let's have some housekeeping rules for this session. All participants except the speakers and the chairs will be muted by default during the session. To ask a question, you can either use the Zoom Q&A that you see here in your panel below, or the WUVA Q&A chat of this session, or raise your hand. The questions will be answered during the Q&A session or after this session if there's not enough time. Contact session facilitator Andrea Cilacci that you see here also with us today if you have any technical issues. Okay. Then, of course, you've seen all the wonderful projects and initiatives that have sponsored the EBDVF 2020. Here they are listed again. So after 3 years of research and innovation, the Big Data Stack Consortium is proud to showcase its infrastructure management system for the holistic analysis of big data. Handling analytics on both data in flight and at rest and across multiple data stores and from several sources. So we're very happy to welcome you at the final event, a Big Data Stack for Industry, a focus on retail, shipping and insurance in is big data the real future of emerging business? So the purpose of the event is to raise awareness on the Big Data Stack and the benefits of adopting the Big Data Stack solutions for industry. We've rounded up our Big Data Stack experts and external big data experts from the field. And we've split this into two highly interesting parts for you. First, we'll focus on a big data stack for industry, a focus on retail, shipping and insurance, where we'll talk about our pilot use cases, smart insurance, connected consumer and real-time ship management. And then after the coffee break, we'll continue with the big data expert panel that will engage us in a lively discussion on a big data stack for industry. Is big data the real future of emerging business? So the session chairs of today, it's myself, Marieke Willems, it's Andrea Cilacci. You see him here, it's Digital Marketing Communication Specialist at Trust IT Services, and Yosef Moati, Senior Researcher of IBM Research Haifa, Big Data Stack Coordinator and Data Services Technical Lead. Now here briefly, I showcase all the speakers. So it's Demosthenis Kiriasis, Assistant Professor of University of Piraeus, Bernard Quesada, Project Manager of Merchant Services in Worldline, Maurizio Maglioglia, Project Manager at GFT Italia, Statis Blitzos, Senior Researcher and Head of Development at DCIP Technologies, and Anesti Sidiropoulos, Team Leader of iLab at ATC. I'll dive deeper into their bios when they're up to take the stage. So this first part consists of the following. We have a short intro that's this. Then Demosthenis Kiriasis will talk us through a big data stack for industry, and then we'll focus on the different pilot use cases that we have, and we'll close off with a live demo of the big data stack user interface. So I would like to ask you to enter the Slido link at WUVA. Andrea, can you walk us through this part?
Yes, Malik. So I'm going to share this link through the chat, either on WUVA and on Zoom for ones that are connecting directly to the Zoom platform. So we would like to ask to all our attendees to please dive into the link. They will find a questionnaire, a few questions, and they will be able to reply to our question. This will allow us to understand who is in the audience. So to better address the speaks of our speakers and even questions when they will come. So I think that is better if we leave the questionnaire open for the entire session. There are a couple of open questions so people can have time to reflect, think about what they want to put in and reply.
Yeah, it's for us also to get an understanding of who we have on the call. So as soon as their first results are in, Andrea, let us know so that we can use them for the discussion as well.
Yeah, ask whenever you want, Malik.
Okay, so without further ado, I want to pass the floor on to Dimas. Dimas, I'll be introducing you with a short bio while you're setting up your slides. So Dimosthenis Kilias is an associate professor at the University of Piraeus Department of Digital Systems. He has a background in electrical and computing engineering, techno-economics, and holds a PhD in the area of service-oriented architectures with a focus on quality aspects and workflow management. His expertise lies with service-based, distributed and heterogeneous systems, and he has participated and coordinated several European-funded projects like BigDataStack, 5G Tango, Matilda, CrowdHealth, Orbit, Cosmos Vision, Cloud, Irmos, etc. Dimas focuses his research on issues related to distributed computing architectures, data management and analytics, performance modeling, deployment and management of virtualized infrastructures and platforms. Dimas, the floor is yours.
So good morning, everyone. Good morning also from my side and welcome to this session. Now in this session, we have thought of structuring it around different technologies that have emerged from Big Data Stack project. Having followed a couple of sessions in the last 2 days, it's really interesting and very impressive, you know, how many innovative and interesting approaches have been developed and are applied for, big data and AI analytics and data management in general. Now, all these approaches, and you know, this was also our thoughts when we were starting this project, the majority of the approaches focus on how do we optimize analytics, how do we perform analytics on different data sets. So it's mostly, you know, you see on the analytics part, and that's of course very important. But when we started Big Data Stack, we were thinking that there are other pieces in the stack that are also of major importance and need to be taken into account. So there are different techniques and frameworks like Storm, Spark, Flink, TensorFlow, you name it. And all these provide the tools to analysts, to big data analysts, to perform their analytics. But you know what happens on the underlying layers, and how can we optimize analytics not only on the frameworks part, but also on the data management and resource management part. So that's the core focus of this project. That's the need we're trying to address and we're addressing. We look into the bottom layers and the goal and the solutions that will be presented and discussed today also apply to different scenarios. Look on an end-to-end, I would call, a holistic optimization approach that goes beyond the typical analytical frameworks, also to the infrastructure layers and the data management ones. So Big Data Stack at the end is a data-driven management system, or this is the bottom layer of it, let's say. It enables infrastructures to respond to the needs of big data applications and big data operations. And of course, to facilitate that, we have a set of enablers that range from the deployment and orchestration of analytics pipelines, so chains of analytics, and of course also of composed applications that deal with big data. There are a couple of different enablers, techniques, and outcomes of the project that are quite interesting and can be applied also on different, settings. So we don't need to go on a full bundle or on a full blown deployment of Big Data Stack to take advantage of things that have been developed in the project. There are different bits and pieces and bundles that can be utilized and get the added value of them without having the full solution ready, and I will come back to that later. So what do we offer? We address, as I said, since this is a holistic and end-to-end stack, we address a different set of stakeholders and at the end different set of roles and roles in the big data ecosystem. The key solution is what we call the data-driven infrastructure management system, which is recently referred to as AI ops. So, you know, operations on the infrastructure and the management levels that are driven by AI and analytics. This was also our idea when we started the project, and we have specific solutions for that. Now, besides the infrastructure providers, we also address different roles and different stakeholders. Of course, the data scientists and data practitioners. We have a solution which we call a data toolkit that enables them to ingest their analytic tasks and to perform analytics, taking advantage of the underlying layers. We have a set of tools that, you know, we bundle them together and we call them together as data as a service. These address the needs of data providers, decision makers, data management experts, of course. There are techniques and outcomes of the project that are quite interesting and have also been recently released as products. It's also something to note for later on this presentation. Now, besides that, we have also thought that, you know, more and more there are business people and, you know, business analysts and decision makers that need to also be engaged in the overall analytics process, since at the end, as the decision makers, you know, they also want to get the outcomes of the analytics or specify specific analytics pipelines that they would like to perform. Now, we thought that we need to address this group of stakeholders as well. And for that, we have developed and we have released what we call a process modeling environment, a framework that enables business analysts to specify their processes. So this is, you know, high level processes that would like to be performed, like, I don't know, customer categorization, customer segmentation, and things like that. And then, you know, they should not deal with any details related to how are these mapped to specific algorithms, how are these being deployed and executed on the infrastructure. Of course, not how are these being optimized on infrastructure level. So let these business analysts specify their business process and business flows, and then the overall environment and the stack deal with that and provide them with analytics. So there, you know, these are the big bundles, I would say, or as the outcomes of the project, which all, you know, come together to a technical, conceptual in architecture. I would not get into, you know, many details about that. I just want to stress a few things on this slide, one of which is all this data-driven infrastructure management system. There are some very interesting parts here without, you know, the intention to highlight some and hide others. So these come from the data management, data storage layer, where, you know, we have added techniques and we have specific solutions on how this is adaptable because of the load, because of the different analytics that are being performed. So for a number of reasons, this needs to be adaptable during runtime, and how we support that is quite interesting on the infrastructure layer. Besides that, I think it is also of quite interest to see how we at the end realize the deployment of an application and we optimize the orchestration of it. For both of these steps, we have the corresponding techniques that are AI-based. So for example, we exploit reinforcement learning for orchestration and, you know, dynamic orchestration, so being adaptable during runtime according to what is happening. Last but not least, I would also like to stress what we call the triple monitoring engine. So what we have developed and we have linked with the different requirements of big data applications and operations is an engine that provides additional information going beyond the typical application-related metrics and resource-related metrics to metrics that correspond to data operations and data services that are also being deployed and thus need to be monitored if you want to have a complete view and tact upon that. All this, you know, is related to this big, I would say, gray box that is called data-driven infrastructure management, as I called it earlier also, you know, our AI ops approach to the things. Now, on top of that is data as a service. Just to, you know, to briefly highlight two topics you will also listen later today. One is the data skipping. a very innovative and also productized now approach from IBM. We'll come back to that later, and the seamless data analytics framework that allows analytics to be performed on top of different stores without, you know, the need to go into ETLs, etc. And on top, everything that we call a user interaction layer that addresses the different stakeholders, as I described earlier, you know, about the data analysts, the data toolkit addressing their needs, the process modeling environment, and the automated process mapping mechanism into that, you know, a kind of AutoML approach, enabling the business analysts to specify their processes and business flows, but not deal on how this will be mapped to analytics. And the dimensioning workbench, which responds to a core need and a core requirement on how do I dimension my application and my big data operations when I get into the infrastructure layer, what resources will be needed, how these resources change, so, you know, the full elasticity model in time and in response to different events, such as, you know, the users or the workload. So all of these come together into an overall end-to-end, as I said, holistic approach. That's why we call it, you know, a full stack for big data applications and operations. Now, this session is about industry, and as we call, you know, a big data stack for industry. So here are, you know, four highlights from my side that I think are of interest for everyone attending this session. One is, you know, the first one, what we call the seamless analytics, of course, with the corresponding asset properties. What do we enable through this technique and, you know, this project outcome, store and analyze, you know, through different queries, a data set that is federated between a database and an object store with additional optimizations, like, you know, how to move the historic data from the database to the object store and techniques about that. A second quite interesting, I promise to come back to that, you know, a while ago, the data skipping, optimizing analytics performance. This has been, you know, GA'd already from IBM for four different services. So it is related now to the IBM SQL query service, the IBM analytics engine, the Watson Studio, and the Cloud Pak for Data. As a general availability now, you know, approach, and we also have the information that it will most probably soon also be released as open source. Besides that, you know, the data skipping and, you know, the optimization rules about that has also been contributed to Apache Spark. So this is a core outcome of the project with different targets and already availabilities. What we discussed already, AI operations for infrastructure management, I'm just highlighting two techniques over there. The deployment configurations and how we optimize deployment through different ranking algorithms. So we want to see the deployment options for a set of criteria, evaluate them, and of course rank them and proceed with them. So, you know, based on learning algorithms for ranking. The second one, dynamic orchestration, what we call AI-driven orchestration at the end, it exploits reinforcement learning for orchestrating application and data services and performing the orchestration in a dynamic way, so being adaptable during runtime as things happen. The I would say last highlight is, you know, the performance boost we have achieved on the infrastructure layer. This has been achieved through a number of ways. Here I'm just mentioning one, the Courier container network plugin, which provides up to 9 times performance gains compared to OpenShift SDN. It is something that has been already being tested and evaluated by the Australian government. And recently, you know, it's something that has also been mentioned and has been included into the latest, I think it's the 2022nd, OpenStack release or the Victoria release, about the native integration with Kubernetes with the network plugin of Courier to optimize the delivery of networking into containers. I would like to stress that, you know, these are not the only outcomes of the project, but I think these are some highlights which are already exploited, have been already released in different ways, and really provide added value to the industry, as you will also see later on the corresponding presentations from different use cases and different application sectors. So that's it from my side. I don't know if we open the floor now to questions or if this comes later on.
Well, we can take one question if there's one question, Andrea, for Dimos.
Sorry, Monique. No, there are no questions in the chat.
Okay, so just to remind everyone that's in this session that you have the opportunity to ask our speakers questions through the Q&A, both in Zoom and on WUVA. Then I'd like to move on to our next speaker, Bernat Quesada. Bernat, while you're preparing the sharing of the screen for your slides, I'll briefly introduce you. So Bernat Quesada has a computer engineering degree from the Polytechnic University of Catalonia and is currently project manager with the Merchant Services Division of Worldline. He specialized in e-commerce solutions for the retail sector, and previously he has been working for more than 15 years within the retail and industry divisions of Atos as project leader and business expert in projects related to the field of warehouse automation. Bernat, the floor is yours.
Thanks, Marieke. Good morning to everyone. Hello. Before I go any further in the presentation, I would like to set a bit the scene of the use case. We are in charge of, one of the members in the consortium that are in charge of testing the BigDataStack platform. We are specializing in the world of retail, but concretely as Marieke said previously, we are specialized in e-commerce. So that's the field on which we have been developing a prototype that is going to be used for the test of the platform. Okay. When we think of connected consumer, we have to think of a customer of a grocery shop who is able to connect to the apps of his favorite shop through all kinds of devices, ranging from a personal computer to a mobile phone, tablet. From all these devices, thanks to this, our user should be able to receive personalized promotions and products according to a number of different things, such as his tastes, according to his purchasing behavior in the past, and things like that. No, and in this is in what we have been developing our prototype. Okay, in the we have to think then in the world of e-commerce and of a user that is using a loyalty application, etc. No, things like that. Okay, once I have set up the scene, I will go inside the presentation. Okay. First, I would like to talk about what is the business context and what are the opportunities that are because of the business context in the world of retail related to big data and to analytics, to big data analytics. What is the retail business facing? Basically, a highly competitive market. We have in the last years the appearance of global competitors such as Amazon and other global companies that through the internet are able to sell goods to their users. We have also local competitors and regional competitors. No, all of this has made the reality to retailers more hard. No, and for this reason, each customer is very important for them, no? And then in order to keep these customers, what they need is to provide the customers with an attractive offer that differentiates their site and their offer from others, no? And this is the current situation, but what is the challenge for them in these moments? And in what can be helping Big Data Stack and analytics? We have been thinking of personalization. Okay. Currently, what all these, or many retailers, not all of them, but some of them, a number of them, they are offering their customers in terms of personalization is simple, or simply they just don't offer any personalization. And they are basing, for example, the customer segmentation to offer special products or offers to the customers on traditional and not update customer segmentations based on age, gender, and residence of those customers. They are doing it by their own historical data and not taking into account tendencies or the context. They are also not linked to external data sources like social media, and for that reason, for all of these things, they are unable to produce the predictions at the right pace. No, they are not able to produce recommendations or personalized offers to the customers in real time. No, that some of them, and that's something that big data stack can help with. No? So for them, predictive analysis it is something that can help them to adapt the messages they are showing in to their customers so that they are personalized and also to send, for example, only those promotions that are more interesting for the customer by analyzing what is their behavior in the past. Which kind of promotions they are choosing in the website in the past, for example. They can also it can also be predicted what are the potential buyers for products or services. If and we will see in the next slide how we are dealing with this. And again, for all this, they can improve the shopping experience for customers, no, by using predictive analysis. And this is what the use case is about. It okay. So if we go further and we try to set up a bit more about the context of the use case, we are not alone in the project. We are collaborating with an external company, with a grocery company, one of the largest grocery company in Spain, that has more than 3,000 physical stores, 1.2 million products, 1 million customers, and 3,000 million ticket items. And that's the data set or the data we have been provided by this partner that we have in the project. The partner is specialized in grocery, which is also the field on which we are mainly working in the field of e-commerce. Altogether, this means that we have been provided by our partner of around 1 terabyte of data, okay, and the challenge we have is to build a prototype, a recommender system that is able, as a collaborative filtering recommender system, that is able to personalize the products that are offered to the customers, and in this way, to increase the customer satisfaction and loyalty, okay. And all of this done over big data stack. No, this is the challenge. Okay, so if we go further, what is the application architecture of the system we are creating? Basically, what we have is a batch analytics process, which is calculating the recommendations on a periodic basis. Okay, then we have also a real-time analytics process, which is calculating recommendations according to the events that the users are providing in the e-commerce site. Okay, and then we have a layer for the external applications like the e-commerce or the loyalty applications, which is providing recommendations to those applications of the ecosystem of our customer that needs to have a recommendation for the customer. Okay, this layer service is getting the data from the analytics that has been calculated in real time and in batch by the other two subsystems that are implemented. Okay, all of these application is, as you see, is a a composed application that has many, many, many different processes that needs to do analytics with big data, some of them in real time, and all of this has to be put over big data stack. Okay, and what how we manage to do that in big data stack? That's the next slide. In big data stack, the responsibility of defining and implementing a big data analytics application is distributed in at least three different roles: the business analyst, the data analyst, and the application engineer. Big data stack is providing special tools for each of these roles, for each of these people. This is something that we will see in the demo later on with Anestis. The first step when we have to develop our application, the one that we saw the architecture before, for example, our application, our connected consumer application, is that the business analyst, with the help of the model processing framework, defines at a high level what is the flow of the application. It has the business analyst has to select those tasks that has to be done by the application, and it has to link this task from this graphical user interface, the model processing framework. Okay, he has also, or he can set the objectives for these data flows that he defines. For example, in the previous slides, in our case, we would define one flow for the batch analytics with the different processes, with the three processes that I was showing before, and we would connect those processes from this tool. We would also set the objectives for these data flows. For example, we could say that in the real-time analytics process, we want to fix a time to value as a service level objective of this process. Okay, we could also say other objectives, like the time response, for example, that we want to set for the services layer. Now, all of these objectives will be taken into account later on for big data stacks, so they are fulfilled and the application always is running and what is expected. Okay, this is the first step, no? To define the business process. Then, as the second step, what we do is that the data analyst has to first, for those tasks that are analytic tasks, has to choose which analytic algorithm he wants to use from a list of available algorithms. It can also be allocated automatically, this analytic algorithm. Okay, this is a feature that the big data stack provides us. It has to map each process that is an analytic algorithm with its analytic algorithm. Okay, to concretize, no, in a way, and this is done by the data analyst in the second step of the definition of the application. The data analyst in this step, he also has to define the analytical flows. He has to link those processes with executable files. For example, in our case, the feedback collector, which is the first process of the real-time analytics, the one receiving all of the feedback from the user, would be linked to a web service. Okay, and he also has to set the values for the application service service level objectives. Okay, he has to set the concrete values for the time response, for example. Okay, once he has done all of this, then from the data toolkit, which is the tool that is used, it is generated a playbook, okay, a YAML file that is used in the step number three for the deployment of the application. Okay, this file allows the application engineer to deploy the application via the application dimensioning workbench, which is the step three, is the application that is using BigDataStack for the deployment of the application. Okay, and in this step, a big data stack allows the application engineer to choose the preferred deployment pattern among a list of different deployment patterns. Always deployment patterns that fulfills the quality of service levels that has been defined by the data analyst and the business analyst in the previous steps. Okay, and that's the way that the application would be defined. All of these steps will be later on be seen in further detail. Okay. And last but not least, what are the features that are being provided by Big Data Stack to us? The required resources. We don't know how many resources our application will require. We cannot dimension our application many times. Making the capacity planning for a big data application needs to be tackled in a different way than in classic monolithic applications. Due to the big amount of data to be processed in different moments of time, resources need to autoscale in order to absorb the massive amount of information coming from heterogeneous data sources. In Big Data Stack, as I said previously, we are defining our service level objectives, and from the first deployment, the application dimensioning workbench of the platform is proposing us to allocate those resources. Okay, and this is one of the important features. Another, the provisioning of resources. The provisioning of resources is nothing that has to be done manually. This is done also automatically by the application dimensioning workbench. So we needn't to worry about machines or which type of machines or nothing like that. No, this is done for us. What else are we offered? We are offered once the application has been deployed with runtime adaptations. During runtime, there could be new data sources, different rates in the incoming data, and the infrastructure needs to adapt automatically to accommodate these changes with the objective of always guarantee the service level objectives fulfillment under any circumstances at the minimum cost. This is especially important for in the world of e-commerce, for example, when we have a peak of sales to keep, you know, and Big Data Stack could guarantee us that we needn't to worry for what is the activity in the system, that we will always have the necessary resources, no, for providing in our case the real time recommendations, no. And what else is provided by Big Data Stack? Big Data Stack is providing us with end user tools like the ones I was mentioning before, and that we will seen in the last part of this session. Okay, so that's it from my side.
Thanks, Bernat. And it was very interesting to see how the solutions provided by Big Data Stack can help retail in terms of the required resources, the provision of resources, the runtime adaptations, and the end user tools. It was also very good to see that the flow the process of the users. And now, if there's any question on from the audience to Bernat, I would like to give space to ask one to attend one question. Andrea, have you seen any questions for Bernat? I think there's yeah, one. I think there's one question from Yuri Demchenko, right?
Sorry, Marika, I was reading the question.
Don't worry. I have not heard magic word cloud. Are you using cloud for resources scaling or bursting? Sorry. Bernat, do you want to answer that one?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. When he says bursting, can he provide me with more information?
Can we unmute Yuri?
Yeah, I don't know if Yuri wants to take talking and talk himself, but for sure we can.
Okay. Bursting means that
Yuri, you can talk if you want.
Okay. Yes, looks like I'm having the unmute. bursting means from the old classical scenario cloud burst, then resources are rapidly outsourced to the external public cloud. This is the same as scaling.
Thanks, Yuri. So Bernat or Dimos, jump in if you want to answer this question.
I think Dimos is more ready to do it, because this would be the inner part of the Big DataStack platform. For us as users of the platform, what we are doing is using the application dimensioning workbench, and this is the one providing us the resources. We have not to worry about what is doing underneath of us. So I guess maybe.
Thanks, Bernard. Dimos, do you want to add something to this? I think we can't hear Dimos. Yusuf, do you have any additions here?
So this is a good question. The Big Data Stack platform can in fact be used either in-house, on-premise, or it can be also very useful within the cloud. What Bernard has been experimenting and with his use cases was for in-premise environment. That was the context.
Thanks. Thank you for the question, Yuri. Very interesting one. So without further ado, I want to introduce our next speaker, Statis Plitsus. Can you set up your presentation while I'll briefly present you? So Statis Plitsus is a senior researcher and head of development at Deep Sea Technologies, a proud member of the Danos Corporation. He holds a PhD in operations research and decision support systems, and he has worked in many national and European research projects over the past 3 years. He focuses on Internet of Things, big data optimization, and artificial intelligence approaches for the shipping industry. Statis, the floor is yours.
Okay, so good morning, everyone. Marike, thank you very much. I'm here to present you the second use case of Big Data Stack that is related to the shipping domain. We call it real-time ship monitoring. I prefer to call it the seafarer's tale. First, a bit about Danaos Corporation. We're one of the largest independent owners of modern large-size container ships. We have a proven track record of operational excellence and technological leadership. Our distinct edge in advanced shipping and technology and long track record of safety, efficiency, and environmental responsibility helped us forge very good and lasting relationships with our customers. Last but not least, since we're talking about a corporation, it's not only a shipping company. We also have a software house which was built in the early 80s due to our deep understanding of the shipping domain. So apart from shipping services, the Danaos Corporation, the customers of Danaos are not only charterers, they're also other shipping companies that use our software. Okay. In this presentation, I will present you, I will show you one of the solutions we offer that is related to online vessel monitoring, and how we use and utilize Big Data Stack to deploy the related applications. As long as a tricky scenario, which was firstly implemented in the framework of Big Data Stack. So The real-time ship management objectives, in the way we see it, refers to fuel consumption tracking, how much fuel the vessel is currently consuming and get against how it should consume. Hull trap optimization is the second objective. This is related to marine life grown in the bottom of the vessel, especially during periods where the vessel is idle. This is an extra load, not that significant for the vessel, but it basically causes overconsumption that can go up to 15%, for example. The third objective is machinery troubleshooting. And this is where the tricky scenario I previously talked about takes place in the framework of Big Data Stack. And last but not least, it's the environmental compliance. How we do it, we go on board on a vessel, we install aggregators or sensors, we use a satellite connection to send this data to our data storage. We augment this data with meteorological data, winds, waves, and sea currents. And we use AI algorithms to estimate the behavior of the ship, the behavior with respect to the fuel consumption, and the behavior with respect to the hull drag optimization case, with respect to the machinery troubleshooting case. And all these results are presented to the end user, which can be either the ship owner or a charterer, to via a web platform or a mobile application. The onboard installation, well, I'd like you to imagine the vessel as a floating factory, because I'm going to use this argument later on. The thing about sensors on board, it's the vessel, as I said, is a floating factory. It's a very difficult environment with constant humidity and high temperature, especially in the engine room. So each device someone installs there should be first made by marine appropriate materials. These devices should be resistant to high temperature and humidity and all these difficult conditions that I discussed previously. Also, data security takes place, and you really need a scalable network, because you have to go through, you have to install the devices within a metal box, literally. I mean, the engine room, especially, and the vessel as a whole, is a metal box. So wireless communications are, in the way we know them, Wi-Fi, for example, are not applicable. While cabled connections are too expensive. This solution more or less addresses the case of a real-time monitoring, of a real-time ship monitoring scenario. The market needs we face from our customers is that, okay, simple data logging is not a solution anymore, okay? We believe that ignorance and over-information are the two sides of the same coin. So just logging data to the user is not helping him at all. He or she needs actionable information. And it seems that since we're in the era of Internet of Things and big data, analytics over this data, this amount of data, is mandatory. The scenario we're addressing via our applications and how we utilize Big Data Stack to enhance the performance of our applications. So the scenario we're addressing through this combination of big data stack and our application is the following. We all know that vessels have time-constrained routes. So when a main engine part fails unexpectedly, the vessel may go off hire. This means because chartering revenues decrease, replacing the broken part urgently increases cost, and also it's very bad. It's a very bad image for your shipping company. So if you could potentially identify these failures timely, you could order the spare parts and replace them before they fail. The thing is that identifying malfunctions in general in the main engine, in the engine room, especially in the main engine, it is a vast problem. As I told you, a vessel is a floating factory. There are a million things that can go wrong there. We focus on a specific malfunction of a specific spare part called crosshead bearing. This is a malfunction that is not sudden. It evolves gradually. The bad news about this malfunction is that it can only be detected with an onboard inspection, because to the best of our knowledge, there is no known correlation of metrics that we collect to predict it. We know the main cause of this malfunction, though. It's called slow steaming. It's a very common practice imposed by charterers. It's used basically to save fuel. The thing is that main engines are not optimally designed to work in such slow speeds. So slow speeds means that the cylinder is not optimally lubricated. So this component wears out first. So we wish to predict these breakages, and we strongly believe that this malfunction as a physical phenomenon is somewhere hidden in the data. So we wish to reveal it. On the left side, you can see the higher level architecture of the cylinder. Right in the middle, you can see the crosshead bearing. And on the right-hand side, you can see an article from C-Trade Maritime News explaining that slow steaming is a practice that had happened, is happening, and will continue to happen. So this malfunction, this kind of malfunctions caused by this practice is something that we strongly need to address. The technical challenge is that many parameters are related to the malfunction. It is difficult to accurately predict failures. There is the very possible scenario of data loss due to broken sensors on board, and also identifying patterns is in general a very data intensive and computationally demanding process. The operational challenges we face: premature alarms increase the operating costs because they lead you to order unnecessary spare parts, and also the part replacement, especially the price of the part replacement depends on where the replacement will take place, when it will take place, and who will do it. So within Big Data Stack, we've offered three categories of data. The one is operational data. We call them telegrams. It's not an actual telegram. It's just the shipping domain kept the term of a telegram because they used the telegram in the old days to send these reports. They're actually reports, emails, okay, manually generated by the captain or someone on the crew, summing up the conditions, the weather conditions, the fuel consumption, and more or less a summary of a voyage. So we offered in this project 47,000 records. These reports are generated every 12 hours or upon arrival or departure of the vessel. We have the second category, which is general purpose sensor data from 21 different sensors on board. We collect data on board on a per minute basis, and the total sum of the records of this category is 64 million records. And the third category are main engine sensor data from 100 different sensors on board. Again, on a per minute basis, summing up to 64 million records. I understand that this is not big data, let's say, but given our customer contracts, we expect a sharp rise in the number of monitored vessels, as well as the daily size of generated data per vessel. So this data volume will increase dramatically. So we want to be ready for the following days when the shipping company, where more shipping companies will come to us and ask for this service. So how we use Big Data Stack? This is something that Bernard also displayed, so I'm not going to add so many details on this step. There are four steps for you to use Big Data Stack. Step one, you need a business analyst to define the process for you. Define the objectives, design, as I said, the process through Big Data Stack with the responsive, with the respective tool. And the output of this step is a process map, which is passed to step two. In step two, the data analyst takes control and augments this process map with more steps on the process, defines data sources, for example, external or internal, associates a step of the process with an algorithm, an analytics algorithm, for example. In our case, this step involves the association of identifying malfunctions with the respective preventive maintenance algorithm, which was built in the framework of Big Data Stack. So the final output of this step is the playbook, which is practically the full application model. In step three, the application engineer deploys the application, monitors and optimizes the deployment. So the final output is your application. In our case, the solution I previously described. And the fourth step, again, the application engineer gets to maintain the ecosystem of all these things, optimize the resources when needed. And for us, this is where we get the business insights and all the decision support related information. So if I could, okay, in order to use Big Data Stack, all components are utilized. Dimos, in the first talk, showed a big picture of, a detailed picture of the architecture. So practically, in all scenarios, all components of Big Data Stack are utilized. But I would like to pinpoint some components of major importance. We perform real-time stream processing by distributed complex event processing. This is one of the components used in Big Data Stack to identify sensor malfunctions or business rules violations. Second, within Big Data Stack, the University of Piraeus helped us develop a preventive maintenance algorithm, which taps on the data quality assessment service. So the data quality assessment practically cleans and filters out data. And it seems that this preventive maintenance algorithm, as a total outcome, is quite efficient and considers all available data sets by the deployment configurations. The third point which I would like to stress here is that Big Data Stack offers a seamless data movement and data analytics module to handle data sets distributed both at Linux scale database where fresh data are stored and object store where historical data lie. Last but not least, through the data skipping technologies of IBM, we have enhanced SQL query performance against object stores, against even remote object stores. So that would be all from my part.
Thanks, Tatis.
Any questions?
Thank you. Thanks for showing the need for actionable data for Big Data Stack and how Big Data Stack makes this possible for companies such as Danaos. So it was also very good to see the Big Data Stack roles that you need in your company to be able to deploy this. I don't know if there's any questions for Statis, Andrea? Otherwise, Okay, perfect. Then I would like to move on to Maurizio. Maurizio, while you're preparing your slides, I'll briefly present you. So Maurizio Maglioglia is a project manager at DFT Italia, and he has a background in information technology from the University of Genoa. And he acted as project manager in several European projects in areas like smart cities, Internet of Things, technology, enhanced learning, and linked data and analytics. He joined DFT in 2017 and is currently working in Horizon 2020 funded research projects such as Big Data Stack, FinSec, and flagship Infinitech. Maurizio has published several referred papers in international journals and conference proceedings, and the most relevant scientific background includes technology-enhanced learning, knowledge management and ontologies, and big data and analytics, future internet technologies. Maurizio, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Marike. Good morning. I'm Maurizio Megliola from GFT Italia. And I'm presenting the use case smart insurance developed with the support of GFT Spain in the context of the Big Data Stack project. A few words about GFT. GFT is a multinational company based in Germany with more than 6,000 employees and very active in European financed research projects. And based on technical consultancy, our customers are mostly in the financial sector, especially banks and insurance companies. So framing the business context, insurance companies increasingly need IT database solutions in order to address their needs about the provision of tailored services to the customers, in order to increase their satisfaction and loyalty, as well as the provision of a smarter customer relationship management system. At the same time, data analytics in the insurance industry is transforming the way insurance business operate. Data and analysis have always been the basis of the insurance industry, and in the last years, the evolution of ICT solutions in data analytics reflected in an increase in the number and value of investments. On the other hand, 80% of industry professionals believe organizations which do not use big data will likely become uncompetitive. So that's why insurance are leveraging data to attract, retain, service clients and producers, develop new products and so on. So Big Data Stack gave us the chance to experiment the project's innovation through a use case in the insurance context. GFT collaborated with an insurance company based in Italy, selected from its customers' portfolio for the provision of corporate dataset, including information such like customer behavior, customer history, customer demographics, and so on. According to the GDPR directive, all the sensitive information of the datasets have been anonymized. And in addition, a set of open data about societal, geographical, macroeconomic information and so on have been provided to the project. So the pilot includes two scenarios, product recommendation and churn prediction. The first service based on the similarities between customers from corporate datasets and the geographic location where the customers are present, this service will recommend policies to the customers. Churn prediction, this service based on the above information and their relationship with the cancelled policies, will predict the probability that the customer is going to cancel a particular policy. So as far as the policy recommendation scenario, several recommenders based on collaborative filtering and supervised machine learning were developed and evaluated. As far as the collaborative filtering models, they revealed two main limitations with our data. That is, the average number of items per user is very low, thus making any user item matrix factorizations technique difficult to work. And then the impossibility to introducing policy content features like the type of user and location. So a machine learning classifier implemented as a product recommender was finally chosen. Here, the target is the product or products which are more likely to be acquired by an existing or new customer or group of customers. This solution was selected over hybrid recommender since the variables related with the location are specific to the policy. And the best results were obtained with tree-based classifiers. Other advantages of this solution, as products can be recommended to new customers, potential areas of specific combinations of features of new customers can be identified for commercial expansion. Tree-based ML classifiers are compatible with modern explainability techniques. And the model is flexible enough to be continuously improved with the new corporate and open data. And besides cross-selling implicit in the machine learning model, also upselling could be later implemented at the post-process stage. Regarding the churn prediction scenario, here the goal is for a given user to calculate the probability that the user will not renew an existing policy. A policy level churn prediction is modeled with the data from both active and cancelled insurance policies. Customer retention is one of the main goals of customer relationship management systems. Given that the business, the cost for customer acquisition far exceeds the cost of customer retention. Churn models aim to identify early churn signals of customers with an increased probability to leave voluntarily. And most of the exploratory data analysis and extract transform load phases is reused from the previous scenario. For example, we are only interested in the owner of the policy as the actual customer. And the model developed here is a machine learning binary based in naive Bayes and random forest classifiers. A few words about the implementation. All the work has been implemented and evaluated in a BigDataStack OTD pod with one Linux container in Python and Spark. Library, the full EDA and ETL stages of the corporate and open data files are performed on Python pandas, which were selected for outperforming PySpark in the ETL stages with the data available. Libraries used, the collaborative filtering models were evaluated with PySpark alternating list squares, and the Python ML solution was finally selected due to a small amount of data available for modeling with training times lesser than 2 seconds. The Sharp prediction model is also implemented with supervised machine learning in Python for the same reasons of the recommender. As far as the deployment, a Flask web server app in a Python container with the training and inferences services is used to deploy the solution. And here, all the pipeline, including the model training, can be executed in a Python Pandas scikit learn within a few seconds. Additionally, this service could return the prediction explained. So this was the machine learning application. Now, what about the Big Data Stack? Big Data Stack platform is the perfect candidate as backbone for the full management of the data collected by insurance companies. Because this platform has the right tools to make the data from different sources and of different formats meaningful, and to manage them in the full stack of related applications. From an engineering perspective, our use case centers around the development of Big Data Stack compatible applications that enable the two scenarios described, which are configured, deployed, and orchestrated via the Big Data Stack platforms. Big Data Stack covers both the pre-deployment phase, process modeling data toolkit, and the runtime phase, providing the required resources, runtime adaptations, and finally end users tools. This slide, as seen in the previous use cases, represents the 4 steps of the life cycle of a Big Data Stack application. So the step 1 with the business analyst defining the objectives, step 2 data analyst add more detail defining the algorithm association, producing a playbook that is used in step 3 by an application engineer for trigger the deployment, configure the application and optimize and monitoring, and finally for the maintenance and the resource optimization. And I would like to give you some few more detail about used by our use case of the Big Data Stack platform. From the step 1, the use case is triggered by the business analyst through the creation of a high-level graph through the process modeler component. And the business analyst can define also the overall objectives of the application. Subsequently, the graph is propagated to the process mapping component, where in some processes, wherever applicable, the selected machine learning algorithm will be further assessed based on the selected overall objective. As a second step, the data analyst consumes the graph proposal in the data toolkit component. There, specific values regarding the overall objective are also coupled with service level objectives supported by the pods at the infrastructure level, are fine-tuned, and the result is the generation of the playbook, which is a YAML file. The playbook later on is directly posted to the realization engine, where deployment of the application can be invoked and managed. From within the realization engine, the application owner can view the different components of their application. For this use case, this includes the insurance recommendation service, the churn predictor, along with the supporting services such as containers for training, updating the machine learned models for those components. These components can be either manually deployed by the user through the realization engine, or otherwise managed automatically through a container responsible for the application business logic. The last step of this end-to-end application is the visualization of the analytics with many possibilities offered by the project. Also, the system features a web REST API that could interact with the insurance company as a web service. In conclusion, a look at the business opportunities. Our smart insurance company can use the Big Data Stack platform to efficiently deploy the product Commander together with the Champ Prediction System to improve the user experience and satisfaction and enhance the business results in a number of scenarios. Like, for example, provide online product recommendations at any contact point with the customer, whether it's at the insurance renewal or when the customer contacts the insurance company by any reason or any channel. Use product recommendations on marketing campaigns, and this will mostly performed in batch mode for selected group of customers. Online on-demand channel detection at the customer interaction point with the insurance company for quickly reaction or take advantage of the contact situation to try to reverse the customer drift to leave the company. Finally, periodically or in reaction to external factors like competition campaigns for increased customer retention. Thank you. This is all from my side.
Thanks, Maurizio. Thank you very much. It was very good to see how BigDataStack helps to improve business results through the product recommender and improve the user experience as well. We've seen now the three use cases. You've seen that there, you've seen the similarities and the differences between them, and we'd now like to ask Anestis to prepare his live demo. So that we can see what the user interface looks like. Anestis, while I'll briefly present you, please prepare your screen. So Anestis Sidiropoulos is a graduate from the School of Informatics, Aristotle University in Thessaloniki. He has over 10 years of experience working as software engineer, and he has strong professional skills in agile methodologies and telecom infrastructure. He has been focusing on full stack web development and DevOps, and currently is team leader in the iLab team and Google DNIs. Anestis, the floor is yours.
Hello from my side. First of all, can you see my screen?
Yes, we can. Perfect. Okay.
I'd like to welcome you in this presentation as well. In my part, I will showcase briefly and also in detail what we have achieved in the level of the user interface. As you can see, this is the landing page. The user needs an account. For time purposes, I'm just going to log in as an administrator so you can see the full capacity and the potential that the user interface has to offer. As showcased before, both from Bernard and Maurizio, I think the platform provides access to three main roles. First one is the business analyst, and the respective component is the process modeler. The second role is the data analyst, and the respective component is the data toolkit. And last but not least, the application engineer has access to benchmarking, dimensioning, workbench, and the analytics. We will go through all of these components in detail in the following minutes. So without any further ado, the whole process starts and it is triggered by the process modeler component. So the business analyst logs in, and as you can see here, this is the relevant component. Here, the process model, the business analyst through process modeler can define a high level graph as mentioned before. We have a palette of, a rich palette of processes here. The user can select the nodes and then connect them. And also for each one of these nodes, we can furtherly assign the attributes as desired. And in addition to that, the user can define the overall objective, which is in essence, what is the overall goal of this process. For all of three use cases, we have defined graphs. So to save some time, as you can see, the user can import graphs and further fine-tune them. As you can see here, we have a graph for the real-time ship management use case. By clicking on each of one nodes, we can see the attributes and what is selected. And also you can see that for this graph, the overall objective specified is accuracy. So we are interested in accuracy. We want to fine-tune this graph in order to have as an overall objective the accuracy aspect. Of course, we can choose cost, response time, and throughput, or we can choose multiple overall objectives. So at this step, when business analyst is concluded with the high-level graph, he can export it, as you can see there, and pass this graph and the states to the data analyst through the toolkit. Or, as explained before by Maurizio in the GFT case, we can see that we can invoke another component, which is the process mapping. And what this component does is it takes into account all the selections on node level in specific nodes, for example, in a regression node. And then taking into account also the overall objective, it assesses the user's selection. So if the user has selected, for example, in this regression node, the random forest regression, and he's interested in accuracy and cost, through the process mapping, this choice may be further assessed and the algorithm may propose a different solution to achieve this goal. So in any case, we can either send the high level graph towards the process mapping component and then consume it in the data toolkit, or we can directly go to the data toolkit. Hence, at this stage, the actions of the business analyst are concluded and the floor is passed to the data analyst and the respective component, which is the data toolkit. Data toolkit has been designed at least in UI UX aspects to be very close to the process modeler. Once again, the data analyst, which is considered to be more of a technical expertise person, can import once again the generated graph from the business, from the process modeler, which is this graph. And then we can see that we have the exact same graph. And now it is time so we can fine tune specific values in this graph, such as SLO, some constraints, some limitations, etc., etc. As you can see here, before I chose that the display unit is accuracy, so the overall objective is accuracy, so the user is interested in the accuracy aspect. And then on each node, we have further options in order to fine-tune and define different values that are considered to be constraints, etc., etc. So at this point, when the whole graph is furtherly fine-tuned, the data analyst is at the stage to produce the first version of the playbook, and then hence pass it subsequently towards the third role that has access to this platform, which is the application engineer slash owner. What the application engineer and slash owner will perform through benchmarking and dimensioning workbench components is, it will take as an input this first playbook and then deploy it and at the same time monitor it to see if there are any violations in qualities and to see and acquire general metrics and data on how the application is performing. At the same time, there are different algorithms running on the back of the deployment to propose even better modified and optimized deployments. So a whole circle of deployments, monitoring and redeployments is triggered through these components up to the phase and up to the point where we reach that the deployment is optimized and efficient in the better way towards the user. For time purposes and only time purposes, I'm not going to deploy something because it needs some time. At the moment, there are several deployments in the background for all three use cases. And the result of the application dimensioning workbench is for an application to be deployed. And as an end result, the user through this panel, last but not least, can start acquiring metrics on how the applications are performing. So for example, in the connected consumer cases, you can see here, based on the application that is deployed, we are fetching some data through an API And you can see now, for example, that we can acquire metrics both from the real-time update model and the detailed feedback analysis. The real-time update model gives us some results about different products that are considered to be high selling points, and also about the detailed feedback analysis showcases some specific actions on based on products, such as if they are added to basket, if they are removed from basket, etc., etc. In a different use case, such as the real-time SIP management, we can see, we can see different aspects of the data that are visualized and different components of the visualization API. First of all, you can see the predictive maintenance algorithm. Up to now, only the results are visible here, but as Stathis Plitsos has demonstrated before in that case, we can see that the algorithm predicts when the vessels are going to malfunction in a more efficient way, and then the relevant actions can be taken into account. We have another component, which is the data quality assessment, which can be accessed through this panel. And also we have also incorporated some other graphs and some other dashboards through third-party components to see alarms and memory and CPU-based data received from vessels. Of course, this all of this UI is designed in a way that it is very dynamically adjustable to the needs of each user. And last but not least, in the GFT case, you can see that, as showcased by Maurizio before, we have an API that provides us with different analytics data based on geolocation criteria. This only applies for the region of Italy, but it is expandable to taking into account all the geolocation regions, depending on from which sources does the API get all this data. So in a similar way, you can see that the UI is developed based to accommodate all of the components acquired and used and demonstrated by the three use cases. But I would like to stretch out at this point that they are flexible and adjustable to accommodate any use case by defining all the processes and then using process modeler, data toolkit, dimension workbench, and all of the components of the big data stack framework. I would say that from my side, I have concluded with the demonstration. So please feel to ask anything that you would like to ask.
Thank you, Anastis. This was very interesting. I don't know if there's any questions from the audience about this demo. But the demo.
Hello, Marik. No, there are no questions from the audience, honestly.
Okay.
It's very interesting. So thank you, Anastis.
It was really good to see how this works. Yes. Thanks. Then if there are no questions from the audience, I would like to ask Andrea, could you guide us a little bit through the results from the survey that we've done with the people on the call and to understand who has been engaging with us in this first part of the Big Data Stack final workshop?
Sure, Mike. Thank you. Indeed, it was very interesting to see that a lot of people in the audience is coming from the industry sector. So a lot of them is working with big data. So I think there are all people that retrieve insights and solutions with the big data stack platform. They almost everybody are interested in deploying solutions on the cloud. I think it's for the purpose of performances, of course. What else? We have an even split in between people who try to outsource big data solutions for the business and people who want to have them in-house. So this is quite interesting because we are looking at the shift into the market. So people are trying to retrieve solution and put them in-house to have full control. Then we have challenges that people think are the most relevant when working with big data in the company or in general. And I can see that there are trust issues, then there are security performance issues, lack of talent costs, integrating many different data sources, and this is something that could be only, you know, solved with big data, for instance. Lack of knowledge about big data technologies to use. And again, we're seeing with analysts that the whole process with big data stack is extremely seamless and streamlined. So what is the main barrier or risk preventing you from implementing big data analytical solution in your organization? Well, the 60% of people reply lack of expertise. And again, I think that it couldn't have been more easy than that. Thank you, analysts, for I'm sure that everybody could, you know, face big data solutions nowadays.
Thank you for that, Andrea. Thanks again to analysts for the demo. So without further ado, and I think everybody's desiring a coffee at this time of the morning. But at 12, we're going to be, I think it's 12, yes. So at 12, in half an hour, we're going to be back with the second part, a panel discussion moderated by Yosef Moatzi from IBM Research about is big data the real future of emerging business? And our big data experts, Ray Walshu from the BDVA, Celine Shu Tatu from Custobar, and Satis Blitzos from Deep Sea Technologies will provide us with very interesting insights from their own expertise and their own sectors. So please come back at 12, so you can also engage with our external experts on the real future of emerging business. Is this big data? So thank you for this first session. Thanks.